Lacrosse Legends. Lacrosse Legends, a comprehensive look at America's greatest game, featuring legends past, present, and future.
Today on Lacrosse Legends, we chat with Syracuse University lacrosse legend Jovan Miller.
Jovan Miller, two-time NCAA Division I lacrosse national champion, two-time first-team all-conference, two-time All-American, all-centennial team at Syracuse University, Major League Lacrosse All-Star. Lacrosse Legends caught up with Mr. Miller during his recent visit to New York at the world-famous Tracks Raw Bar and Grill. New York!
Pinstripe Bowl. I hadn't seen some of my friends in a good time. Syracuse was playing Minnesota. Figured I'd support the former school.
How did Syracuse do?
Lost by 8. Yeah. Threw a pick 6 in the third quarter. I think that deflated us, but saw a lot of good friends, so it was worth it.
Hey, you grew up in Syracuse, around Syracuse, right?
Yes, sir. Born and
raised. You went to a Christian...
Christian Brothers Academy.
I was
yes, sir.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Henniger High School, is that close to Henniger?
Yeah, my parents went to Henniger.
Oh, you did? Okay, yeah, we just finished interviewing Curry from Henniger High School.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, it's a small world.
Yeah,
right? Absolutely. How about that, huh?
Yeah.
I understand you were a standout football player.
Once upon a time. A long time ago.
How'd you gravitate towards lacrosse?
I did it accidentally. I was looking through the channels. Syracuse was playing Princeton in the national championship game. I didn't know what lacrosse was. I couldn't stop watching it. Syracuse ended up losing in overtime to Princeton. And from watching that game, I literally said, I think I want to try that. That's literally how I got into it. I saw it and I just was drawn to it. And then I asked my parents if I could play. They signed me up and it kind of just took off from there.
This was while in high school or prior to high school?
I was in seventh grade.
So you didn't even pick up a lacrosse stick
until I was about 12 or 13, yeah.
Wow.
It wasn't a matter of like thinking I could have excelled in it. It was just interesting. Mm-hmm. Every time I kept playing it, there was something different that I was doing, or something different. I was watching somebody else play. And it was interesting. And it was like, I couldn't do that. I wanted to learn how to do that thing. So it was more or less like each time I went out there to do it, it just was something that new that I had never seen before. Or getting a concept down that ultimately when I first started playing, I couldn't do. And it just became easier and easier each time I did it. But I was a better football player than I was in the front.
So after Christian Brothers Academy, how did you go from there to Syracuse?
During that time, I was getting recruited for both sports, football and lacrosse. A lot of the schools are actually pretty comparable. So, like, if I got a message from Syracuse for football, it was also for lacrosse. It was like for Chapel Hill, same thing. It was like, might have been one for lacrosse, but they knew I played football as well. So I was a standout in both sports. So at least a lot of the schools that I was interested in me, they were lining up. But as far as the offers and stuff, I mean, they were pretty much, right down the middle, were both the same. It was just a matter of making a decision.
You were in the ranking class of the Bratton brothers?
Yes, we were the same age. Yeah, in that class, the Brattons were 1 and 2. I was 18th in that class. I ended up in Syracuse, and then again, it just came down to mutual interest. Obviously, you want to go somewhere, but you also want them to want you. I knew that the Brattons, like, once they had made their commitment, a lot of things followed. In that class alone, I believe of the top 5 recruits, 4 of them went to Virginia. But I knew we were going to have a really good class as well. How I ended up in Syracuse was actually kind of an interesting story. I originally wanted to go to Maryland. I don't know, I just didn't get the interest. We never talked money. I think that was the main thing. I never talked money with them. Wanted to go there, ended up not going there. But it was down to Chapel Hill, Syracuse. My parents were still watching me play. We were at the Empire State Games, if you remember those.
Mm-hmm.
So I was playing in the Empire State Games, and we were playing against, we weren't playing against, I was still playing high school, against a kid on the other team, who had an older brother that was at Chapel Hill. And my decision came down to Chapel Hill, Syracuse. Ironically, my parents sat next to that family. The mom was telling my mother how long it takes to get from Watertown, New York. So they would talk about right after work, they drive down, drive through the night, get a hotel, drive the rest of the way, watch the sun play, get in the car, drive halfway back, get in the hotel room, then drive back to Watertown to be at work on Monday. Long story short, they were talking about a turnaround of about 18, 19 hours between the trip there and back. And my mom was like, absolutely not. So I said, okay, my mom had only seen me play twice in high school. So here's the deal. If I go to Syracuse, because I'm a local kid, if I go to Syracuse, you got to go to every game. She said, okay. And I committed to Syracuse next week. Yeah, that's how I got the cues.
Next on Lacrosse Legend. You're watching Lacrosse Legend.
The day begins with a prayer and a prayer to excuse my sins. I can walk anywhere I choose, because everybody listens to the BDP crew. We're not here for glamour or fashion, but here's the question I'm asking. Why isn't young black kids taught that? They're only taught how to read, write, and act. It's like teaching a dog to be a cat. You don't teach white kids to be black. Why is that? Is it because we're the minority? Well, black kids follow me. Genesis chapter 11 verse 10 explains the genealogy of Shem. Shem was a black man in Africa. If you repeat this fact, they can't laugh at you. Genesis 14 verse 13, Abraham steps on the scene. Being a descendant of Shem, which is a fact, means Abraham too was black. Abraham born in the city of a black man called Nimrod, grandson of Ham. Ham had four sons. One was named Canaan. Here, let me do some explaining. Abraham was the father of Isaac. Isaac was the father of Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons, for real, and these were the children of Israel.
After Syracuse.
Sure.
Your career took you to the MLL?
It was MLL at the time, yes. Got drafted 8th overall in that draft to the Rochester Rattlers. We were in rebuild, so we had a lot of young guys. Ended up right after that season, got traded to Charlotte. So Charlotte for about a year and a half to 2 years. Played for the Charlotte Hounds their inaugural season. Made the All-Star team that year, it was pretty cool. And then after that, I kind of started to bounce around because I stopped playing as much. I had a situation that happened off the field, which was kind of like a boycotting the league.
Okay.
It's an interesting story. But yet after that, I felt like I got a lot of scarlet letter.
Okay.
I played a total of about 6 years.
Queens University in Charlotte?
Oh, no, man. I stopped coaching there in 2015. I do all youth stuff now.
All youth stuff?
Yeah. Okay, I work with the Carolina Miners out of Concord, North Carolina. So actually the upper part of, so northern Charlotte for the most part. Yeah. Cover Huntersville, Concord, Cornelius, all the way up the way. Yeah, I've been working with them now going into my 5th year.
Yeah, and how is that going?
Been tremendous. Been tremendous.
Yeah. What's your message to the person who's the only whatever on a team?
Honestly, make sure you're surrounded by people who are making an effort to understand from a cultural standpoint. If you're not around people like that, that are at least trying to get intrigued by, or not intrigued, or not interested in getting to know who you are as a human being, especially from a cultural standpoint, you're not going to have the most enjoyable experiences. So I would just say, as you go through your journey in the game, just, I'm not saying pray for it, but just be surrounded by people that are, from a cultural standpoint, that are receptive and understand that you might be a little different based on how you look, based on how you present yourself. And they have to be open to that for protection's sake for you when you're going to play on the team. So safe haven has to be your team, and make sure that you don't water down who you are so that you can fit in with the team. Be your authentic self, and of course you want to be along the same lines of what you want. Don't minimize, don't water down who you are just because you're different, because your culture is different as well.
What's your message to the young man who knows that he can play a tag, but he's given a long pole and is forced to make an adjustment?
It's the one time you're always tested on the, I'll do whatever's in the best interest of the team. Don't have a bad attitude about it, even if you don't agree with it. Just don't be a distraction in it. Circle back at some point in time and talk to your coach about what can be done if you want to play. If you feel like you can help them from the standpoint. But yeah, it's the first time you actually get tested on the, I'll do what's in the best interest of the team. If it's going to get you on the field, do it, at the same time, and it's something that you feel like you might be just as good, if not better, than the guy in front of you, you want to respectfully go to your coach at some point and have a conversation about it. Live with the decision that he comes up with too.
Field lacrosse or box lacrosse?
Box. I never got to play it, and I love watching it. Oh, it's those guys are magicians. Box by far. Absolutely. Box.
What's in store for Mr. Miller in
2023? To get back to podcasting, I love that part of my life. I've gone away from this since my dad had passed away, so I haven't done an episode in about 2 years. But I'd love to start getting more interactive when it comes to just outreach with the game of lacrosse, even if it's outside of just coaching it. I want to expand some horizons, man. Mm-hmm. Got some opportunities and talking to some people. I think it probably would be to get back to some of the basics, get back to some of the things I absolutely am passionate about and love to do, and try to do it more consistently. So it'll be 3 years in May since my dad passed away.
I'm sorry.
But yeah, after he had passed, I didn't really get to go back to doing it. I loved doing it. It was a far gone, like never really took an actual chance to put my stuff out there. But I would love to give him a sport radio somewhere.
You mentioned your father.
Yeah.
I remember reading in an article. It was a comment made to your father after a game, something to the effect of get your black ass. Yeah, the way you handle it, you have the patience of a saint. I got to give it to you because I don't know if I would have handled it the same way. Is the environment changing in the lacrosse world?
I hate answering this question because I feel like I'm Mr. Negative. I feel like there's just been I believe that people have just simply evolved in the way that they are, not to say hateful, but I would say, willingly ignorant. From what I've seen in my time, it has varied in the way in which you can see some of that disconnect, especially at tournaments. Tournaments are usually the worst way where you see it the most, because it is kind of, it's not really structured for people to step in. You got your 4 games and you go play your games, and you don't have an official, you have your officials on the field, but you don't have a tournament official that, or at least representatives at each location, let's just say they're the 2 different sites on the same property, that really try to govern what's said on the sideline by the parents. So personally, I feel like, no, I've only seen, it's just people have gotten more clever on how they present themselves. So my dad, for example, like I actually, when I started getting good, it was like, right at the beginning, the very beginning of what club ball was today. So when we played, it was this guy's name, Mike Becker. His dad reached out to a kid from just about every respective school in the Syracuse area. He got really good play. And I was one of the kids. Showed up at practice. It was like 17 of us, and we're all from different schools. And he just said, we got 4 tournaments. We got 1 in Philly. We got 1 around the corner. We got 1 in Watertown. We got 1, I think it was, in Massachusetts. Come on, come play. And that was the first time I'd ever been at, like, travel ball stuff. But it's morphed into something so different. It wasn't like we paid the fee and then just went out and played. We didn't have any structure to it, but I was at the beginning of it. My dad never sat with the parents. He sat down in like very, very corner, out of sight. He did that when I was in high school. He didn't do that when I got to college. He wasn't sad. I think it was a little bit different as I got to college. But for the most part, most of the time, it was completely away from the parents. It was only when something maybe had jumped up on the field, where maybe a parent was saying something crazy to the coach, or the coach was saying something crazy to the ref. And it might have been because I checked the kid too hard or something like that, and with the ball of his son, I saw him become a little bit more present. He would start working himself closer to whatever. But for the most part, I think he like stayed so far away.
A tough situation, man.
Yeah, I think so. I think that you have the fear of not being present, especially because he was such a present black man. I know, unfortunately, from a perception standpoint, we're not given the opportunity to present that all the time. because he was so involved. I felt like, you know, he was always in fear of that, it being about him. So for the most part, a lot of his interaction was usually after a game, where the parents would come up and like, your son's really good, he's doing great, or whatever. But he never was involved, never wanted to be the helicopter parent that you talk about, telling what the coach we can do, whatever. Luckily, I was good enough to where he didn't have to worry about that most of the time. But I think that was a big thing for me when I was going through, was that he didn't make him, he was very quick to like be away from listening to parents talk, whatever they were talking about.
Next on Lacrosse Legend. You're watching Lacrosse Legend.
The ignorant rapper is done. Knowledge reigns supreme over nearly everyone. The stereotype must be lost, that love and peace and knowledge is sore. Do away with that and understand one fact. For love, peace must attack. Sorry. And attack real strong, stronger than war, to conquer it and its lore. Pictures, stereotypes and fake history reinforces mystery. And when mystery is reinforced, that only means that knowledge has been lost. When you know who you really are, peace and knowledge shines like a star. I've only shown you a simple fact. It takes a nation of millions to hold us people back, which is whack, but we can correct that. Teach and learn what it is to be black, cause they're teaching birds to be a cat. But ask yourself, homeboy, why is that? The girl.
Let's talk about solidarity.
Sure. I wish that a lacrosse, when social issues arise, racial issues arise, that involve demographics outside of the majority. When schools, organizations want to be involved, especially when it comes to mistreatment of a group of people, whether that be LGBTQ, whether that be black people, whether that be Hispanic people, whoever. I wish that they stop with gestures and start to go out with action. A lot of times, it's almost like being at the cool table. Everybody wants to put up some very nice, neat comment or nice, neat, you know, publishing thing. Look at us, we're for this, and we do not accept yada, yada, yada. But you never talk about steps to which, you know, you go about that. We never have, how often do you have conversations along the lines of racial injustice or things of that nature? And solidarity to me is a very lazy way out, because I believe most people, 99% of people, call themselves in solidarity or call themselves supporting something, don't really believe what they're actually trying, what the agenda that they're trying to reach. Mm-hmm. I feel like solidarity is a dangerous slope, it's a slippery slope, because there comes a time when all these social these gestures of these political, these mission statements or whatever are tested, and you are nowhere to be found. So if you're going to be one of those people that steps to the limelight of social or racial change or justice, and you want to do something about it, mean it, and be willing to sacrifice something in the process if you're trying to progress, progress everybody as opposed to like your own agenda.
Great point.
I think that what people don't understand is I have outstanding resume. Two-time first team all conference, two-time all American, two-time national champ, all centennial team of Syracuse. Not many people have that kind of resume. People miss is that they assume that because somebody had a great career, that they had a great time and a great experience. Winning is great perfume on hot garbage. So once you're done playing, a lot of dudes don't want to come back and give back, because even though like Dumpson and those guys, they're legends to me. They had great careers. I may have had a little bit better career, but the point is like they paved the way for me. But if you didn't have a good experience, why give back to it? If there was no empathy towards your experience, why give back to it? And I'm not saying that you shouldn't try to forgive and forget, you know, but forgive and move on. But the point is, if you never address, it's really hard to like push an agenda of back in my day, it wasn't like this when I was growing up, and you're not the affected party. Mm-hmm. So like I said, for me, I look at it like there were a lot of men of color, a lot of women of color that had outstanding careers. And they're like, well, why aren't they giving back? Or why aren't they, you know, coming back to do anything and supporting the school? It's because the experience outside of the playing field was a dumpster fire, and they are not willing to go back to it.
Great
question. Jim Brown.
Great
Jim Brown. I mean, Jim Brown's like, yeah, he's one of our greatest. And the point is, like, and like, he doesn't come, if I'm not mistaken, like, the last time I saw him at a Syracuse event was at MetLife Stadium, and they were playing Duke. And I had already graduated, and Drew Jenkins, my buddy, one of the homeboys, he was on the team. He met him in the locker room or whatever. But other than, you know, he didn't go to Syracuse University to go say what up. You know, New York City's right here, so he was like, let me just stop by, show my face, and then dip. You know what I mean? So you listen to experiences like that. I mean, shoot, you know, Bill Russell didn't even go to his own jersey retirement with the Boston Celtics. You know what I mean? Bill Russell's like, Bill Russell's Bill Russell. And Bill Russell didn't even go to his own jersey retirement with the Boston Celtics. And a historically great player for an organization. He's won X amount of championships as a player, coach X amount as a, you know, as a coach, as a player coach. And was said, I had such a terrible experience as a player and as a coach. Even though I've given you all of this, I'm not even going to show up even though you're honoring me. So I think it's a great example of, not saying the books, but I'm saying, you get so many of these experiences where I'm bald, I'm playing my behind off, I do. But I don't feel obligated to come back and help you, and I'm not going to. And so you'll talk to me, ask me questions about, you know, how was your time there or whatever. The playing field was great. Outside and off that field, it was a different story. So I think you see a lot of people fall into that category of like, yeah, I was that great. I was that player. I was whatever. However, my experience wasn't the best. And they kind of stick in that. It wasn't the best experience. A lot of times you have a very hard line of, should I say what I'm really thinking? Or, like you said, do I keep the door shut, push a little further open? I think in my experience at least, luckily, I had such a great experience. Or I had a good enough career to where all I have to do, my experience at least, is speak truth to power. And all you can do is hope that enough people understand. He's not saying that because I was a bench warmer. He's saying that because clearly, even as successful as he was, something didn't connect. That, and I want to be clear that it shouldn't be about that I didn't try to ingratiate myself. You know what I mean? It should be more about maybe the culture wasn't right. And, you know, with Rodney, with Mr. Dumpson, like, they won three championships. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, people have this assumption that because you win, like, that just cures them all. That there's not scars after. You know what I mean? All that work. And it hits some of us a lot harder than others. So when I look at him and I listen to him talk about it, I'm heartbroken. Because I get it too. Ultimately, you have to look at it from an agenda standpoint, and you have to ask yourself, is it worth me making a stink of it? You have to ask yourself that. If it's worth it, then don't care about the door being open or shut, because hopefully the right people hear it. It hits them the right way. You have to pick and choose your battles. It's like one of the most important things about the minority experience in the game of lacrosse is picking and choosing your battles.
Yeah.
You know, and so I understand that he might have a different experience. I've also been the first to tell you, sometimes I don't know if it's the best thing. There have been some times where I definitely think it's the best thing to just air it out. Absolutely. You know what it is? And you get to a certain age where all my guys, like, I graduated in 11. We're all so far removed from college. Some of us got wives and kids. Some of us, obviously, we all moved on. We have careers. We've done what we're supposed to do. Syracuse helped us get where we are. And now we're productive citizens in the world. To that point, I don't plan on, I think, and Roger, I can't speak for him, but I would assume that, look, man, we're in his case, they're in their, you know, 50s, you know? What do I care if the guy, I'm not his roommate anymore, you know what I'm saying? I'm not his guide, you know, I'm not his godfather to his children or something. So it all comes down to, like, whether the rapport that you have with your class. Are there certain things that I wouldn't share publicly? Yeah, but it's because it's not my business to tell. Do I feel like there are obviously some people that are very comfortable in their position that know they could say more but choose not to? Absolutely. Do I also know that there's probably some things that they need to be addressed, regardless of whether it messes up and fractures a relationship with, you know, with the alum and with the institution? Yeah, but, like, you got to be willing to. Somebody's got to be willing to, like, put their foot out there. You got to be willing to put it out there. I know for me in my class, I don't owe Syracuse anything. I'm not saying they owe me anything either, but they got the most out of me, and I gave them a lot of too. And they got a lot out of that too. You know what I mean? If somebody looks at it from a turncoat, you know what I mean, a vintage shit, they're not my roommate. They don't pay my bills. Like, you know what I mean? Their opinion is their opinion. But yeah, like I said, there are definitely some things that you got to be willing to, you have to have the courage to put it out there. This was not okay. I had a problem. I didn't want to say it while I was playing. And we are 20 years removed now. Why not? You know, it's not that I'm not lying. You know what I'm saying? Like, and I also don't have an agenda.
Yeah.
You know, I think that people, a lot of times, when you speak negatively on stuff, there's always the assumption that people have an agenda. And sometimes it's just like, that's not the case. Sometimes it's just that happened, you know? And how often can we look at ourselves objectively and say, yeah, we missed the ball on that one. You know, we didn't do right by said player. We didn't do right by said demographic within the program. Yeah, I had a simple question last year. Why doesn't, I'll talk to my school, Syracuse, why don't you celebrate Black History Month? Nothing.
I worked at Hot 97.
Yeah.
I asked the same thing. We're not a black station.
You have to be black to celebrate Black History. Interesting. Or, like, you know what I mean? So there's, like, stuff like that where you're like, so that is more like a, if I say that, I'm cool with saying it. Me personally. I know that I could also see why it might be problematic to somebody else who maybe wouldn't want to say that because of the, I'm not gonna say fear, but it definitely is somewhat fear driven to say, I don't want to say this because of the possible jeopardy. I think that what I've noticed from my time after college was that, God help me, I'm not saying this, but it's a comparable response. So, like, it'll be like the equivalent of, like, a racial Me Too movement, where, like, a player goes through, graduate, and then they start talking. Because now my scholarship's not on the line anymore. I got my degree, I got my career. And then they start talking about, this was what was bothering me. This happened, you know what I mean? Or this happened, and that happened. It's like a Me Too movement in itself, because choose not to say it in the moment, because even if that happened, said thing happened, you're the distraction, unfortunately. And so once you become a starter, you want to stay a starter. I was a 3-year starter. So, well, once you start starting games, you're like, I really don't want to jeopardize that. I don't want to say anything about it, so I'm not going to say anything about it at the time. But then after your college is over, it's hypothetical, so you wait 3 years to kind of start opening up about your experience and certain things. Well, people in your class are like, well, where was this? Why didn't you say anything? And my response when that happened for me was, you're clearly immature. Well, clearly immaturity was a huge factor in this, but you wouldn't listen to me anyway. You only wanted me to say when things were great. And if they weren't great, it was keep it to yourself. So what part of the whole we're brothers was the brotherhood actually being tested when I said something that was wrong about something or something that I didn't like, I was the bad team player. I wasn't the team player for not discussing the elephant in the room. So our whole thing for the whole time, my career at least, was ignore the elephant. You're probably better off just ignoring the elephant.
Man, hurry up and get your podcast going, will you please?
For real. Yeah. Who were your role models growing up?
Growing up?
Yeah.
Syracuse-wise, my favorite player of all time was actually Sean Lindsay. He was a two-time first-team All-American at Syracuse. He resides in California now. I actually ended up building a really good relationship with him through the alumni network. So she's actually had me come out there a few times to do some camps. So he's been amazing. Love that. I love that man. Kyle Harrison, man, was in regards to us, Kyle Harrison was our GOAT, man. He was everything. I remember going to see him play at Homewood when he was a senior. They ended up winning the national championship that year. They played Hofstra, the game I went to with my high school team. We were down there for training camp. I got to meet him. Got to play against him like 20 years later in the league. But Kyle was our GOAT, man. Kyle was everything to us. Kyle was everything to me. And it's kind of cool that he's now a friend. You know what I mean? He still was like a living legend for us, but he's a friend now. But yeah, it was definitely K-18.
Big picture, I may seem like I'm super duper negative, but I just feel like people want kudos for stuff that there's always the assumption that you're not in support of those things. So why do you have to reiterate that you're against racism, you're against misogyny, you're against xenophobia, when it should be kind of an assumption that you're not in support of those things? So when people say stuff like, you know, we stand against racism, like, were you for standing for, you know, were you against standing for racism before? You know, like, why do you have to say that? I thought that I didn't have to go without asking that.
That's great.
Yeah.
You know Chris Panos?
Chris Panos.
Because he's the coach now.
That's what it means,
yeah.
I do. I met him because I'm an alum of Queens as well.
Okay.
Yeah. I went for my second bachelor's there.
Oh, all right.
Coach, I was an assistant coach there. And then I was getting another degree on the side as well. Yeah.
What you just said is like the cultural appropriation thing. It's one of my biggest pet peeves when it comes to lacrosse. Mm-hmm. All the kids in my life now are, obviously they don't know anybody. They don't know Wu-Tang Clan or whoever. But a lot of their content, they love talking about, they love using like the modern rappers, Lil Baby, all the modern black rappers. When they do their little highlight tapes, they use all that stuff. Mm-hmm. Now, cultural appropriation is annoying to me. If you say you don't want it too hardcore, but you also don't really know that from the culture standpoint, you tend to recycle something that's not even yours. Put a lace behind it and it makes cool for your highlight. So like, which one are you doing? Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, accept like the culture part. That's not yours, but accept it. But don't, because Wu-Tang's a huge part of our like growing up. You know what I mean? Like, I guess you could say modern day rappers are part of these kids modern day, but again, look at most of the kids that consume it and they use it for the mixtape. They don't look like this.
Mm.
So it's, I like the music, but I don't like it.
I'm trying to have it both ways. A lot of times I try to have it both ways. And I drive me nuts. I'm on Instagram. Handle is JoviNation23. So JoviNation23.
Well, here's hoping you'll get your podcast up and running. I, for one, will be listening. You'll have a number one fan over here. Thank you very much for coming by. And let's have some lunch, man. Enjoy.
Thank you so much.
All right,
appreciate you. Be well.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
My friend, our legend, so our gift to you.
Thank you, man. Thank you, sir.
This is Monsanto Muzak for Lacrosse Legends.
When I run, the 18th letter, the prophecy professor, I stay clever, long as the planets stay together. Bring a praise from Mecca, make a phrase for the better, and new days to remember, always and forever. The 18th letter, the prophecy professor, I stay clever, long as the planets stay together. Bring a praise from Mecca, make a phrase for the better, and new days to remember, always and forever. The R, baby.